I have the pleasure of interviewing someone in the world of tech and women entrepreneurs that is the closest that we have to a superhero. CEO and founder of a company, more than $100 million in revenue. Right? Superhero? Snaps. And it started with the simple premise of helping people get healthy. Every superhero has an origin story, so I'd like Kara to start with her origin story.
So thank you. I don't know about superhero, but I was in tech as well. There's many jokes throughout the years. I was at a company called AOL, for those of you who remember that way back when. I was employee 70-something and ran this like little button called shopping. And there were guys running all the rest of the channels, and I got a chance to actually ask Steve a couple of years ago. I said, everybody always says, like, did you get the button shopping because you were a woman? And he was like, well, something like that. Yeah, so, but anyway, it was great. I have many, many stories from there, including meeting this guy up in Seattle, Jeff Bezos, who Borders and Barnes & Noble wouldn't actually do a deal with us, so I'd heard about this guy up in Seattle and went up there and helped him build bookshelves. It's a whole other story, but great career there. 7 years, built $1 billion in revenue for AOL. I was their youngest vice president in the company, and after really the turning point for me in leaving was that the United Airlines pilots all knew me. I was flying from San Francisco to Washington every single week, and I'm like, this is not normal. I had two kids, I had a third child on the way, and I was actually asked to be part of the transition team of all my former companies, which started with Time Inc., which became Time Warner, and then CNN, and so my husband was at Netscape, so they were like, you two just come and like be part of this transition team and bring everybody together, so did that. And then I was looking for like the perfect local job in San Francisco. CNET was kind of, you know, incubating around there at the time. And I decided while I was looking for this perfect job, I want to get healthy. And how many have done that while you're like taking a break? And so I started working out, and I was a competitive gymnast growing up. I thought, I know how to do this, and nothing was working. And I loved to like gain weight when I was pregnant. Like I just, you know, loved it. I loved to eat, I loved to, you know, really just go all in for it. And finally, when I just decided I really want to get healthier and not only lose weight, but my skin had developed terrible adult acne, which I had never even had as a teenager, I decided I'm really going to start to pay attention to what I'm putting in my body and see if I can sort of cure it outside of actually taking any drugs, which actually a lot of doctors were willing to give me these diet drugs versus actually looking at what I was eating and drinking every day. Eating was really easy for me. The drinking part of this, my favorite thing, which I joke is probably like I loved this more than maybe even my husband or my children, but Diet Coke was like my best friend since I was probably 13 years old. I probably stole my mom's originally. I don't even remember. But I never really realized that it was actually doing what it was doing to me until I stopped. And so 2.5 weeks after just totally giving up Diet Coke cold turkey, I didn't go down to one. I just like totally gave it up. It was the worst 2 weeks of my life. I lost over 20 pounds in 2.5 weeks. My skin cleared up. I was just like all of a sudden had all this energy. And then after 6 months of living this way, that's a lot of weight, but I lost even more weight. I had lost over 50 pounds in 6 months. And so I actually thought I was sick and went back and saw lots of doctors saying like, I can't actually keep weight on. I'm eating, you know, really healthy things, but I stopped drinking diet soda and that's the only thing. So then I really started to dig into like, why was this? Still interviewing for tech jobs, but I thought like, am I the only one in the world that actually has been tricked by this label of diet and low fat as being supposedly better for me? And I would talk to friends, and finally I just decided I'm just gonna start shopping at like Whole Foods and Trader Joe's, and that's where I'm gonna find like all the healthy things, and that's a farce as well. I mean, there's plenty of healthy things there, but it's not as healthy as sort of I realized. So then one day while I was shopping at local Whole Foods in San Francisco, right on California and Franklin, I became really great friends with, jokingly, but really great friends with the guy stocking the shelves. I didn't know there was like a national buying office in Austin. I was a tech executive, right? I wasn't a beverage executive. And so I had this crazy idea for this idea that I had been doing at home, which was put fruit in water. And it was so simple and so, like, I couldn't believe that the product wasn't out there. And again, there were things out there that were calling themselves water, like vitamin water was one, and it had, actually 15 years ago, it had more sugar in it than a can of Coke. So I'd run into friends that were like, yeah, like that's another thing that is kind of healthy perception versus healthy reality. And so so I didn't even think of it as like starting a company. I never like aspired to be a beverage executive at all. I really aspired to help other people figure out what I was figuring out, which was that health actually is not defined as these words like diet and low fat and things calling themselves water, because it ends up that there's no regulations around any of this stuff. And so again, continue to look for a job for the next couple of years and talk to lots of companies, which maybe some of you guys work at. And I just thought, I'm so passionate about this, and I finally like found my calling where I can actually help people. And like, what better job could I actually have than to just go and develop this product? So
there are a lot of people who cook up things in their kitchen that they think, I could sell this. I can make money off of these amazing brownies with whatever there, you know, is in there. How do you go from that, an idea in the kitchen that obviously people love, you're passionate about, to getting on the shelves of Whole Foods or getting in every tech company, Google, Twitter had a moment, but lots of tech companies stock. Hence, so how do you go from there to there?
Yeah, so I convinced that guy at Whole Foods that I had sort of incubated the idea with to give me a shot on the shelf. I actually, I don't know if you saw this in the research, but I had decided, again, I had never worked in a beverage company or food company, and so my timeline was I was pregnant with my fourth child, and so I thought, well, he's gonna be born on, actually this weekend, May 27th, it's our 14-year anniversary actually this weekend, but I said, what better time than to actually get a product on the shelf than right before he's born, because then I can take a few weeks off and spend some time with him and get some rest. And so so anyway, I thought it was actually gonna happen like a couple weeks before he was born, but it ended up coming a day before he was born. And so that morning, when I was waking up to have a planned C-section at CPMC at 2 o'clock in the afternoon, my husband said, so what do you want to do this morning? Thinking I'd say, oh, go for a walk or brunch. I'm like, let's go to Whole Foods and see if we can get the product on the shelf. And so we did. And I mean, I still like have this vision of the guy at Whole Foods. He was like, wow, you're like so pregnant. You weren't this pregnant 6 months ago. And I said, I know. And I said, look, I'm having a baby at 2 o'clock this afternoon. It'd be really great if you put it on the shelf. Like I can go into labor like much easier. And my husband's just like, oh my God, is she really saying this? And he's like, how do you know you're having like a baby at 2? And I said, oh, it's this really crazy thing. Like when you have a planned C-section, like you actually know when you're having the baby roughly. And he's like, wow, I've never had a baby. I don't know any of this. And I'm like, can we get back to the beverages for a minute? And so anyway, he put it on the shelf, and I didn't really know whether or not he was actually going to put it on the shelf because he didn't do it in front of me. And then the next day while I was in the hospital, Justin's born, I get this phone call, and he says, the product's gone. And I was like, and probably a little morphine was still like lagging, right? And I said, so who took it? And he said, what are you talking about? Like the 10 cases that you dropped off, they're gone. And I mean, I just wanted to develop a product. I didn't actually think people would buy it. I mean, it was just a whole, you know, other like moment at this point. And so anyway, at that point, you know, we continued to sell in Whole Foods. And to be honest with you, like maybe a month later, like it really started to kick into gear. I thought, oh, there's all these beverage companies out there that are like doing really well. And, you know, I'm sure it's like super easy to just go out and just like start a beverage company. And, you know, I wanted to do things like not just use real fruit, but also use no preservatives in the product. And little did I know that no one was doing that. And so there's so many aspects about it. We knew nothing about distribution. And I say we because, you know, my husband was actually, he was an attorney at Netscape. And so we were both like, you know, he was taking a break and trying to figure out what he wanted to do too. And so I think he felt sorry for me. He was also watching large checks being written off our personal bank account. So, I mean, there was something invested in sort of this, but he said, let me help you at least like take the cases into to Whole Foods. And I was like, okay, great. And I mean, he became chief operating officer kind of, I mean, frankly, as a joke. And 14 years later, he's still our chief operating officer. We sit right next to each other, which is a whole other story, which has worked out great. But anyway, I mean, I think like there were just so many situations again that every day we just took it as like, we're gonna do this. We have a passion for it. There are people that, I mean, just this morning, I was just telling somebody a few minutes ago, just this morning, I've had 4 emails from people who have said, you've changed my life. Like, I've gotten off of type 2 diabetes medications. I had a cancer patient who just told me that she's getting through chemotherapy and getting through the metallic taste that they get in their mouth. It's not just people who just want to drink water. It's people who write to you, say like, God, like, you have so helped us to actually like get through this. And again, we don't make any health claims, but other consumers are saying like, this thing is like really helping us. So that was like sort of the creation of it. But the story of Google, I was talking to them about a job, and this guy, Omid Cortesani, my husband worked with him at Netscape, and he said, you know, I know you left AOL, and I really want to hire you to come and work at Google. And they were over on University Avenue in Palo Alto. And I said, listen, I've got this, like, you keep calling me, and I think you're really great. And I just want to, like, be really honest with you about what I'm doing. Like, I'm starting this, like, beverage company in my kitchen. And he's like, that is, like, the worst idea. And I said, have you been talking to my husband? He keeps saying the same thing. Like, he didn't think it was a great idea. And he's like, I just love that you're, like, lit up about it, and you're really excited about it. And we just started getting food at Google. And we were like, we haven't even thought about the drinks yet, but I guess it's, like, we should probably have something for people to drink. So here's the chef's name. And so I called him, and he was like, I think Omid's a really nice guy, and be really great. You know, we'll try a couple cases. And I mean, I remember when everybody was saying to me, like, can we have a few cases for free? Google said, like, how much is it? And I was like, you're actually going to pay me for like the cases? That was so great. So Google became like one of our like top customers, like in comparison to like the Whole Foods. And I mean, very early on. And then, you know, as you know, I've shared.
And they invested.
No. So Google never has invested actually, I mean, that's probably a whole different conversation. Right. I mean, probably, you know, along the lines of, if Julian's still here, like it's a topic that she and I have talked about. I mean, I think that it's really interesting because people will say like, you know, you're in most offices in Silicon Valley. You've talked to like, we've, you know, had more, you know, Sand Hill Road venture capitalists who've reached out to us. But I think what's interesting and what I share with entrepreneurs is people invest in sort of what they know at the end of the day. And I think for this product, it's a beverage company. And the amount of people that I've talked to from Silicon Valley investors who have just been terrified of Coke and Pepsi, I'm like shocked at it. Like they're just like, well, they'll, like if you actually like make this thing successful, like they're gonna crush you like a bug. And I'm like, but they've already done like 5 iterations. Like, I don't worry about the large soda guys. I mean,
you had a funny incident where you did meet with the Coke executive. There's a quote there, but I'll let you tell the story because it does show if you believe in what you believe, screw everyone else, right?
Yeah.
I guess that's the short take. I wouldn't write that in the story, but tell the story of your meeting with Coke.
So it was actually a phone call, but they early on, it was probably about a year into starting Hint, and I had, you know, I talked a little bit about producing a product that didn't have preservatives in it, and again, I had no idea what I was doing and was about to give up, and I thought, you know, there's a lot of other things that I could do to make more money, and this probably isn't it. I mean, the distribution, you know, the whole like real estate model that goes on shelves, like it was just all too much. And finally, a friend said to me, you know, I have this friend who's very senior at Coca-Cola. You've built something in the Bay Area. You should talk to him, and maybe he can give you some advice on how to produce a product. Maybe you can even use the Coke system in some way. So I get on the phone, and I had no idea that this was actually going to come out of my mouth. But I was like, yeah, you know, we've developed this thing in the Bay Area. And you know what? You can just have the company. Like, you can just have it. Like, I don't want it anymore. I'll like sleep well at night just knowing that I developed this thing called Hint. Just take the baby and like go be great to it. Like that's all I need. And we're good and you can have it. And he said, sweetie, Americans love sweet. This will never be successful. And so I was like, wait, did he just call me sweetie? What? Like, what just happened? And then, of course, you know, as many women, including myself, do, making excuses for him. Well, he's from the South. He's, like, in Atlanta and whatever. And, you know, maybe that's the way people talk or whatever. But then I realized, like, I just let him just keep talking because I was listening to a large soda company strategy about what they believed consumers wanted. And I also believed that I wasn't doing this to basically compete against Coke. I was doing this for consumer health, which is very different than how the large soda companies and many of the CPG companies think about it. And so I got off the phone and I remember looking at my husband because he was really the only one that would actually still talk to me, even though he thought it was relatively insane what we were doing. I just said, you know what, we have to do this. Like, this is just like what I'm seeing in front of me is just gross and sick. And, you know, we have these four children and how can we like the food system is so messed up and why isn't anybody focused on this stuff? And I also remember one other like really major thing for me. A friend of mine who was actually my roommate in college worked at the Center for Disease Control, and she called me around the time that I was starting Hint, and she said, oh, I'm so excited. I got moved off of poison control, and now I'm working in this thing called type 2 diabetes. And I'm like, oh, like, what's type 2 diabetes? How does it differ from type 1 diabetes? And she said, so people who get type 2 diabetes, there's at that time 2% of the population had this disease, and she said that it's really interesting because they claim to be eating and drinking low fat and things like NutraSweet and Splenda and all of these diet sweeteners, and they have low energy, they can't lose weight, their skin seems to, you know, oftentimes develop rashes or some kind of acne. And I'm like, Paige, that was me. Like, that was so crazy. So, you know, I talk about this a lot, that I don't think, I was never diagnosed with type 2 diabetes, but I think I was something called pre-diabetic very, very early on, and I got it before it got me. And so I was really realizing again that there is you know, this whole world that we trust out there that, again, like, they didn't have my back and they didn't have my family's back. So I felt, you know, people now say, like, this is a mission-driven company, a purpose-driven company. Like, I was just like, I just want to drink water. And water to me was just super boring. Should have been, like, more exciting. I aspired to drink water, but it just, like, I wouldn't do it. So that was the story.
So. You, on your personal website, you've called it, I think, interestingly, a digital resource for entrepreneurs. And if you haven't gone and taken a look, KaraGoldin.com, and you offer a lot of articles, like your takes on really your journey to build this company, you know, and these great articles that are resources, everything from how to, you know, work-life balance to being your authentic self. There are two that I wanted to ask you about, though, conversations or tips that you give. One is, what are essential management skills for the digital era? And there's a lot of management, risk management, time management, but why was that an important piece that you wrote?
So what was the first one?
here, I'll even, yeah, I yeah. cheat, if cheated, I wrote it. Communication, risk management, time management, some technical savvy. The one that I thought was the best, because I'm a data journalist, is understanding the data. Like, yeah. Why are these digital skills that entrepreneurs,
you know, have? I think that it's, so I'll back it up a little bit. I think like the one thing that makes me crazy when I talk to entrepreneurs and, you know, they'll say to me, gosh, 14 years later, you're still running your company, you're still the CEO, you're, you know, like, why is that? Like, there's so many stories about women and men, but getting pushed out. And I think that the thing that I've learned over time is that in order to continue to be the CEO and really run with it, you know, and see it all the way through, you have to know enough about a lot, right? And so I think especially in sort of the communication side of it, you know, we, like, Melissa's over here. Melissa runs all of our social and content over here, and I bother her constantly. Like, I'm constantly, like, looking at it and seeing exactly what's going on. But then also, like, the direct-to-consumer business. I mean, 40% of our business is direct-to-consumer, which a lot of people are pretty surprised about. There's a lot of data components to that business as well. I thankfully knew a lot about that business just from being at AOL. I hired somebody who is way better and more knowledgeable about the tools and how to build it. But it's not to say that I can't go in and actually have a conversation or sort of look at exactly what's going on Facebook and sort of see exactly what's going on with our advertising. So I think it really just boils down to if you really want to lead and you want to continue to lead and you want to see your, you know, your mission through, then I think you need to, like, really understand lots of different tools that your company will be using.
One of the other things that you write about, there's a lot of tips for management and how to deal with difficult conversations, how to fire people. So you can go read these essays yourself. But one of the other ones I thought was interesting was you model the behavior you want other people to follow. Mm-hmm. And everyone says that, right? Anybody who's a parent, you know, you model the behavior you want your kids to see. But we don't often see that in business. So how do you live that? How do you show your employees how to be the way that you want them to be while you're running a business with all the pressure and tension and, you know, risk and decision making that you have to do?
So I was giving this advice to a friend actually this weekend who was leaving a company and, you know, explaining to her, it was like a company that she was 8 years into it. She was, you know, part of the founding team and now they had a whole group of new people that came in and you know, I said, like, there's two ways to leave a company. There's one where you can just say, I've had it, I've been great to you guys, and I'm out at this point, and then everybody will watch that. The other way to do that is to say, like, I've watched my time here, and now it's time for me to leave because it's the right thing for me to do. And I always tell people, I think this is in the article, but I always tell people, like, the last 2 weeks that you're in a company, try and leave with the same excitement that you had the first 2 weeks of getting into a company. Because it's not at that point even about who you're talking to about, you know, you resigning or leaving. It's about all your coworkers. Because in the end, they're the ones that are gonna come back and say, like, oh yeah, she was great, and they're gonna remember how you did that. So I think, like, that's the most important thing. So
we're talking to people who are here to understand women in entrepreneurship. And whether we like it or not, there's a tax for being a woman and trying to raise money. We just heard about the low percentage of companies with women who are founded. But there are many women in businesses throughout Silicon Valley who have led to their success, but those stories are not being told. So you were called sweetie, and that kind of fired you up. But what's your advice to women who maybe do everything right, right? They mind their P's and Q's or whatever, you know, check the data, have the passion, but you're still, you know, faced with that. I'm calling it, you know, graciously a woman's tax. There's a lot of other ways that people have described it. What do you do with that?
I think there's, first of all, I think, like, understanding that whole aspect of raising money. I had, prior to founding Hint, I had never raised money before, even though I had been at companies in the early stages, but I had never been involved in that. And understanding the difference between angel investors, venture, common stock, private equity, preferred stock, understanding exactly what all of that is so important. So I think it's just really understanding all of the aspects of it. And, you know, I'll just say really quick as I'm getting the sign to stop. Like, I you know, we have over 90 investors in our company. 70% of our investors are women. We don't have any private equity in the company. Most of Sand Hill Road, like I said, like drinks Hint. We are like friendly with them. Google's super friendly with us, but it doesn't mean that they invested in the company. So I think it's just, it's like anything else, like find your tribe of people, whether it's investors or, you know, people that believe in you and that really, really like the story resonates with them for any product that you're doing.
Well, I have to say, I love that you leaned into your pregnancy and your, you know, impending cesarean to win over, like use your power, right? That's
totally
what a superhero does.
Say it as it is.
Thank you, Kara Goldin.
Yeah,
thanks
thank
everyone
you.
For your time.